Welcome back to another week of Instigating with Clarkey and Drury, brought to you by our friends at Coolbet Canada, the Listowel Squash Courts, and our friends over at Larry Hudson's Chevrolet Buick GMC here in beautiful Listowel, Ontario. I'm Ryan Drury. That's Clarkey. We are joined. It's a four-pack this week. This is rare. We are joined by two great special guests and friends of the show, longtime NHL and hockey referee Brian Lewis and our friend Jim Cressman, longtime baseball umpire. We're going to have a chat about officiating in sports. Gentlemen, how are you guys doing?
Doing great.
I was doing really good until we tried to get this thing hooked up and get going here. So I got a curfew, guys. Let's be sharp.
Well, that's Crespin's fault. We're going to blame Jim.
Yeah, we'll send
he's
Jim
not a tech
your
expert.
Bill. Yeah, absolutely. All right, let's get right down to business, like you said, Brian. And this is all spawned off of comments last week made by Raptors guard Fred VanVleet. I screwed up last week, Clarkey. I said this was after the Denver game. He made these comments after the LA Clippers loss. Yeah. Producer Adam has the video ready. Yeah, we're going to play
short,
it for
guys.
You guys.
It's short. We're going to play
it's
it.
It's a just short so you little can hear video. It. We want to play it for you guys to get your reaction to what Fred VanVleet had to say about refereeing in the NBA. Here's the clip now.
I mean, I don't mind. I'll take a fine. I don't really care. I thought, you know, Ben Taylor was terrible tonight. I thought that most nights, you know, a couple of the, you know, out of the three, there's one or two that just the game up, you know, and it's been like that a couple games in a row. Denver was tough, obviously. You come out tonight, you're competing pretty hard. The third quarter, I get a tech, changes the whole dynamic of the game, changes the whole flow of the game. And, you know, most of the refs are trying hard. I like a lot of the refs are trying hard. They're pretty fair. They communicate well. And then you got the other ones who just want to be and just kind of the game up. Nobody's coming to see that shit. They come to see the players. And I think we're losing a little bit of the fabric of what the NBA is and was. And it's been disappointing this season. You can look up most of my texts this year have been with Ben Taylor officiating. So at a certain point as a player, you feel it's personal. And it's never a good place to be. That's not why we lost tonight. We got outplayed. But it definitely makes it tougher to overcome.
So that was Fred VanVleet following the LA Clippers loss. I want your reaction, guys, you know, as longtime officials. Jim, go ahead.
Jim can't wait.
What's your reaction?
He dropped more F-bombs than Avril Lavigne did at the Junos.
Yes, he did. But I wonder, though, okay, so obviously your expertise area here, Jim, is baseball. Did you ever get into an altercation where a player made comments to you like that after a game, or you just heard a player make comments like that? What's your reaction to Fred VanVleet saying that?
It would be more of a manager as you're leaving the field. You would get it from a manager. I'm sure Brian would say the same with hockey. You get it from coaches as you're leaving the ice or something, depending on which way you go. But I love how he said, but that didn't cost us the game. But he spent more time talking about that than he did about their poor play. I'll leave it at that.
Ryan, have you ever had a guy like that, like, speak out in the media personally against you?
Not to that degree. I'm sure they have, and I'm sure they paid a price. The difference between the National League and the NBA might have been $30,000 here. It might have been $1.50 at that time. And I don't want to diminish the respect. I think part of it here is, this is the old, what you get presented, this is the heat of the battle. This is it personal. But then he talks about one particular official, Ben Taylor. So I think part of it is, and I tell you, I had this happen with an unknown official, unnamed official rather, and the Edmonton Oilers. And I actually went and had the captain, the coach, and the two assistants sit down with this particular referee to have them understand this is not a love and hate. This is just we're doing our job. And I think here, he knew he was going to get fired. He says that. But I think here, he kind of coached his answer by saying, we get outplayed, all right? And he doesn't like some of the fouls that were called on him. And who am I to disagree? You know, it is a game for the athletes. And I just don't think that we want it. So it's a long way to answer your question. Have people said this? Not to the degree that I read here.
Okay. So let's just say someone did. You guys are just human, right? Now, would that affect you in the course of the next time you played? Like, I know, like, you might You might say, no, it wouldn't, but come on, we're all human. And if a guy talks about you particularly and calls you out, Brian Lewis, how would you feel about that? And how would you treat the next game?
I would not talk to him at all. He's lost his opportunity to discuss anything with me. So if he had a concern and wanted to say, hey, what about this or what about that or whatever, until I heard the words, I'm sorry, then you got to realize what I've said just cost me $30,000. And I think I would, I don't want to say go out of my way, but I would have no time for that athlete until I heard some other words such as, I'm sorry. You know, we all make mistakes. And whether these calls that he's complaining about are mistakes or not, I don't know. But it's a personal attack. And my immediate reaction is, I'm sorry, you've lost your opportunity to talk referee Brian Lewis.
Jim?
I think it's the same in baseball, too, that you're just not going to talk to the coach. If he comes out, he's popped off the night before or something, and he comes out the next night, you're just going to say, hey, I'm not talking to you. You're just going to put your hands up and you're going to walk away from him. Now, if he follows you, then he's going to be ejected from the game because he's basically ejecting himself by following you. But yeah, I was really surprised at Van Vliet. I thought he had a little bit more class than that. And just the way he went about it. And as Brian said, it's the heat of the battle, but still take a moment to compose yourself.
Is it after the game too, though? He should have had a little bit of time, right?
Yeah. Cause there's always that. I think, well, I don't know how it is in the NBA, but I think, what is it, Brian, in the NHL? I think it's 10 minutes before the media can go in the dressing room. And I know baseball has the same thing. I'm not sure what it is anymore because I've been out of the newspaper business.
I can pretty much guarantee he was at least 20 minutes after the game. He had showered, he had dressed, he had time to cool off. He had an agenda.
Yeah, well, he had time to think about what he was going to say too, obviously.
Yep.
He just decided, absolutely, I'm going to go in there and I'm just going to rant and rave. Yep. And in the bottom line, and Brian will vouch for this, it doesn't get you anywhere. It doesn't get you anywhere. And we are only human. So he might not get a break the next game have a call a borderline call that might go against him, where subconsciously the official's making that call. Officials don't go out there to screw a player. But subconsciously, I'm sure it happens.
It
would happen to me as an umpire with a borderline ball or strike call. I just might decide, you know what, I'm going to ring that one up.
Brian?
I think the athlete as well gets a reputation for being one who's a whiner and a crier and whatever. But you got to remember, so do officials. We would talk about I would talk about a player who maybe shot his face off the night before at me or whatever have you. And I'm talking to my fellow officials saying, yeah, that Johnny Jones is, you know, a real pain in the arse or whatever the case may be. And the same thing, then the officials either could be talking about me, the player, and saying, boy, oh boy, that guy whines and cries. I don't think this is anything the officiating business wants. I don't think this is anything the athlete wants. And that's why the league does everything it can. $30 is a pretty significant amount of money to remove from your wallet. And I don't think that anybody wants to buy into that program. So I think here is this official going to get a reputation? Perhaps. And I think the interesting part will be, does anybody else speak up about officiating in general in the NBA, or in particular, do they pick up and talk about Ben Taylor, the official? And we'll just see here where it goes from here. If it's over with, fine. And to Jimmy's point, he had time. He could even decline an opportunity. Was this a media request that we want to talk to Van Vliet, or was Van Vliet saying, hey, I want to talk to the media, it's my turn? And I don't know which it was, but clearly he had an agenda that he was going to vent.
So I'm curious from both your perspectives then on this. And I, you know, Jim, I know we've talked to you about this before. Brian, I'm interested on your take with it first. Media opportunities. There is a growing number of people and sports fans who are starting to become more vocal and feel like referees should be made available after games to answer to the media. Brian, you reffed at the highest level, you know, NHL supervisor. You're still doing supervising work.
He was What's there, your, foot in the crease. He was the guy, foot in the crease.
Absolutely, Fred foot Hall. In the crease. Like, what you had to bring that up, Clarky. What is your opinion on that, Brian? I'll start with you. Should referees, in your opinion, ever be made available after games?
We had the opportunity in my era, and I want to correct myself here before I start. I'm not too sure what the policy is today. We had an opportunity for a pool reporter to come to the officials room. You got to understand, first of all, A, they're not very big rooms. Sometimes we're lucky to get three or four guys in the room. So they're not big, and you could not have a media scrum in there. It was set up that if there were questions that had to be answered, the media had one pool reporter that could come to the room and ask the questions on behalf of the media. So it's always been there. And sometimes it's exercise and sometimes it isn't. Today, I'm not too sure of the policy today. That was there. So the media scrums are not just as easy to be able to say to an official, come on out, sit at the table and do it. To me, if there's a supervisor in the building, he can go in and gather the information in that small room and then take that information out from a media perspective. I am not adverse to an athlete being an official dealing with the media, but you got to understand here, and I'm sure this is the same for players. Players are schooled in how to deal with the media. The National Hockey League wasn't. So if we took somebody, just let's just say you're doing your second game and you missed an offside and the media says, I want to talk to you. Do you really think that's fair to put you before a scrum in a media controlled room? I don't know that that's really good for anybody.
Jim, what are your thoughts?
Well, I agree with Brian on that. You can't put one official in because in the playoffs, you're going to have like 40, 50 media people sitting in that room, and they're all going to be shouting questions. They all want they all want their question and stuff like that, and it just becomes a free-for-all. Baseball is the same way. They have the pool reporter can go in, speak with the crew chief. And then if the crew chief wants that the umpire who was involved in the play to speak, he can have him speak to the pool reporter. But then the pool reporter goes back and shares the quotes with all the other reporters. But I think we're seeing less than that, or at least that I understand in Major League Baseball, seeing less of that situation happening now because of the replay, because now they have an opportunity to correct a fair amount of those mistakes. So they're not getting the case where the media wants to know what happened because they see what happened. The call got changed. Hmm. So I think that's definitely helped.
I want to pick up on that video replay. Brian, how do you think it's working in the NHL? Do you think they have a good balance right now? And the reason I ask is because you can challenge some things, but you can't challenge others. For instance, my Maple Leafs last night, high stick in the face. Well, you can't look at that on a replay. Do you think the balance is proper?
Well, to be fair, Clarky, the officials can. The officials can review the length of the penalty.
All four guys got together and not one of them on the ice apparently saw it, so they couldn't
look at it. The coaches, yes, the coaches cannot challenge for that. Brian, go ahead.
You've answered my question. Thank you.
Well, then why wouldn't they? Why wouldn't they just go over?
Oh, here, let me give you a little bit of a history lesson. Is it Clarky? I didn't know you as Clarky, but apparently it's Clarky today. Chris, allow me to say this. This was set up to aid and make sure that the right call was made relative to the puck going in the net. Right? High stick the puck, kick the puck in, bat it in your glove, and
foot in the crease, yep, and so on.
And foot in the crease and all those kind of things that were that it was there for. To me, is we've gone well beyond what it is for an official today. When I think of all the challenges today, and they even talked about it today from the general manager's meetings that perhaps there would be another one. And the only deterrent is another penalty to make you two men short or whatever. But when we look at what this was set up for to what it is today, it's a long-winded answer to your question. Am I happy with it? No, because we're taking away – I want to be careful how I say it. Our idea being is let's have the right call made.
Mm-hmm.
And we're saying technology and part of the sell to the
officials. But you like the human element.
Well, I still do. It's going to be there. I mean, if I took you back to an offside playoff goal in Philadelphia, would that linesman like to have that over again by replay? Absolutely. With the ID made, the right call was made. As you walk out of the building, the right call is made. And I can take you to a game in Vancouver one night where New York scored at one end, missed, play went on down the other end, and Vancouver scored at the other end. It was nice to be able to back up the clock and say, count this one, don't count that one, reset the clock, and so on. So it's there, and it's there for a purpose. I think it's gone to the extreme today. So, again,
mm-hmm. Is there a way to fix it? My opinion is there's too many guys in the ice. Put one of those refs upstairs and let them review stuff and get the right call.
They're there today. Clarky, they're there today, and there's a video review guy in every building, and sometimes there's a supervisor in every building.
But they don't call down and say, hey, he did get high-sticked.
No, and you're right in terms of that. I can tell you this. When we had a labor dispute one time, I remember being in a building, in a minor league building, and I was on a headset talking to a referee, to one of the lines. No, I talked to the referee with the
idea
during the game. Well, because we were helping lesser experienced people.
Gotcha.
All right. So if there were six penalties called in the game, he called two, I called two, and two, both of us called. So I'm just saying here, it worked out very well.
There you go.
All right. In that case. Closed. Well, but you know what? We're complaining today about a 3-hour hockey game. Let's not make it 3.5 hours.
I was going to say, and the NFL just keeps adding and adding and adding.
Oh, they're atrocious, Jim.
They've slowed their, like, they just keep, every time something happens, they decide, oh, we better add that to making that a reviewable call. Well, that'll be a reviewable call now. Those games have gone to a crawl. It's just awful. I at least applaud Manfred. I had not been a big fan of him. But I applaud him for some of the stuff that they've brought in at the major league level to try to speed up the games. I think the pitch clock is great.
So
it's just the pace. The pace of game is just good. Now, the only thing is, and Larry Milson, who used to work at the Globe and Mail, who I know quite well.
Yeah.
Larry brought up one point that I don't think anybody's considered. Sure, these spring training games are taking on average only 2.5 hours as opposed to 3 hours. But you get into a regular season game now, you're getting the in-inning pitching changes. You don't get that at spring training. You get a new pitcher at the start of the inning. Mm-hmm. They don't change pitchers during an inning at spring training. So we're just going to have to wait and see how that works out.
Yeah.
But I think it's really good. And they've already talked to a bunch of players who said they like it, like because they get into a rhythm. They get into that pace. And that whole thing when batters would step out and have to tighten their batting gloves. Yeah. You golf, your gloves don't get loose. It just becomes a habit.
Yeah.
Like back in the olden days, they used to get out, they had to spit their tobacco and fix their crotch and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
But I really do applaud Major League Baseball and what they've what they're trying to do.
If I can just add to that, while I was in Phoenix, I went to one spring training game. Anaheim at Seattle. And I was amazed at where the clocks are situated. The umpire can clearly see the one out in the field. And there's one up behind home plate, way up, mounted up high. There's no reason why. And I did see a ball called or a strike called as a result of a clock violation. Mm-hmm. But when that game was over, and yes, Jimmy, you're right on the money. They changed it at the inning. I really felt like the umpire was a timekeeper. Because he was giving signals to whoever was running these clocks to make sure, and they were moving. The game was over in 2 hours and 20 minutes. Yeah. I realized that's not going to be real life when their serious games start. But I'll tell you something. We talked to – I was there with a guy that's significant with the Anaheim Angels, and he talked about it, the game moving. He was a pitcher in Major League Ball. Bill Stoneman had two shutouts in Montreal – or two no-hitters, rather, in Montreal. And we're sitting there, and we're talking about how fast the game is. And you know what? Nobody complained about the game being over in 2 hours and 20 minutes versus 3 hours. So I think they're on target with making the game down in a little bit more fan friendly. And as I said before, I saw game clocks there that normally you would see in an arena. And these clocks were there that were exercised by the umpires. The game moved along.
Here's something about that you might not be aware of. Brian, you're talking about being timekeepers. And I'm glad they thought about this. That once the pitcher starts his windup, the umpire can't be concentrating looking at the clock. He's got to be watching the pitcher. He has a vibrator that's attached to his belt. So if there's a violation, when the clock hits the time, the vibrator goes off and it alerts him So they did have a case in a game, in a spring training game, where a guy hit a, I forget what it was. I think the pitcher, there was a pitcher violation. The guy hit a home run. They called back the home run because it would have been stopped normally. And so now they got to start tweaking how they're going to handle that sort of thing. But at least they've got the umpire that he doesn't have to be staring at the clock and then all of a sudden try to pick up what the pitcher's doing. I'm sure we're going to see some cases like that this year where all of a sudden they're bringing back a home run and everybody's going to wonder why, but at least they got the umpires mic'd and they can explain that to the crowd. That's another great thing. I think that, and they've done that in the NHL too, Brian. I think that is great that the officials can speak to the crowd, and just not the crowd, but the television audience. Cause you know, these sportscasters, they know the rule book.
quite typically, a lot of us don't. I can tell you that.
There it is.
OHL
there
it games. Is.
There hey, it oh, is. Hold on. Jim's got one too.
Oh, speaking of one, here's one for you, Brian. Am I on camera yet?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I got that one. I have
a rule book. Yeah, and you're on the back, but hang on a sec. Well, where are you here?
Keep panning, pan the other way. There he is.
There he is.
There he is. Look at the hair on the guy. But this is the best part of this rule book, the 2000-2001 rule book. It is autographed by one Brian Lewis.
Wow.
So what it says, it's called, read it because I'm backwards here.
It says Milt Dunnell, Red Fisher, Red Burnett, and Jim Cressman.
Jim Cressman.
Top notch. Wow.
Yeah, but hang on.
All top notch reporters.
Yeah.
At least 3 out of 4.
Yeah.
Lewis. That sounds like Brian Lewis.
Lewis, you're an a-hole. I have kept that and I've treasured that because that meant a lot that you wrote that in the book.
It sold for $2 at the time, and I don't think the value has increased one cent.
The fact your name's in there.
That's right.
I think it's worth at least $2.25.
Yep, could be
at least because let's be honest here. You're going to be an Ontario Sports Hall of Famer.
That's
later
right.
This year,
congratulations,
Brian.
So Mr. Lewis.
I think that the value is increasing exponentially. Yes, congratulations, yes. Brian.
When did you hear about that news?
I can't tell you the exact date because I can't remember, but I do know I was in Tulsa. Jim Wiley was a person that I knew in the hockey world, and he passed away, and they're having a tribute game to him in Tulsa, Oklahoma. So I flew down to be with his family and friends and everyone else. And on the Friday, I guess, Mr. Gravett called my home and left a message. So I flew home on Sunday, and I don't know what it's about. So I sent him a text and said, "Do you do business on Sunday?" And within 15 minutes, he called me. So whatever day that Sunday was, I'll say probably a month ago now.
Okay.
And walked me through the process and what it meant. And when you do a little bit of homework and you start like it's, I'm going in with Brendan Shanahan. And there are a couple other people like Steve Ludzik is being honored and recognized for his volunteer work at the same time. I think maybe even Joe Bowen. I'm confused relative to there's different people anyway. Some of them I've been actively involved in sports. I used to referee lacrosse as well. And Gaylord Paulus, a tremendous lacrosse player, is going in. So it became a holy moly oly, really. And I started to do, I'll say, some internal looking at it, not realizing the magnitude of it's a provincial honor. And then I started to look and saying, okay, the only other person I could find as a referee, and there's Red Story, but he's in as a football player and as a hockey. I don't know if he's in as a hockey official, but anyway. So I, you know, it's a sort of a rare breed. And I'd say roughly a month ago, I got a phone call to which I had to respond to 2 days later. And it's been quite an honor. And as I said before, when I did a little bit of homework, it's like all of a sudden you realize the magnitude of it. And I'm eternally grateful. And I do have a lot of time between now and October 26th to work on a speech.
Well, yeah, congratulations. Definitely in order. What are you up to now? You're supervising. Are you a counselor still? Are you in politics still?
I am not in politics, 22 years of politics. But at the end, I ran for mayor and didn't make it, which at the end of the day, it's probably, I don't want to say a blessing, but it, what it's done, it's allowed me to take off. I've been to Thunder Bay for university hockey. I'm still involved in university hockey, which has ended now, except for the national championship. I do supervision in Ontario Hockey Association, and now it's playoff time. So I'll be out at hockey games. I said, the only difference is, can you find me an arena that's warm? Because it seems like everything I'm going to is Canada Packers are storing their meat in it overnight. But so I'm still involved in hockey. Today, I had to go to, I'm a board of directors for Community Living North Halton, an agency that looks after, I'll say, young adults that need some help. And there seems to be always something. I don't want to sit here and say retirement sucks, but it's allowed me to go down to the All-Star game where the NHL All-Star game. And we have a granddaughter who's going to university down there. And we're able to watch her play ball. And as an example, I went to Arizona to visit family and go to a spring training game, which I've never, ever done before. And why? Because you're not as involved as you have been in the past. So I don't want to say I'm semi-retired because I detest the word retired because it kind of means you're sitting at home doing nothing, just getting old.
That's what Jim's doing.
Yeah, but he's good at it. So anyway, I'm having fun in life now and trying to spend more time with family. It's very generically, but still involved.
I remember when there was a lockout in the NHL and we weren't doing much at Leafs TV at the time. I contacted you and we did a little story on like behind the scenes following a referee. We mic'd them up. Do you remember this? It was in Georgetown somewhere, I think. But you were the supervisor that night as well. We mic'd up a referee. And I think I've told the story before, but the one thing that stayed with me that until this day is how the officials are a team as well. Like you have the two teams that are competing against each other, but the referee and linesman want to have a good game too. And like after the game, there was high fives in the dressing room. Maybe they were putting on a show for the cameras. I don't know, but I was really like thrilled, I guess is the word, to see the joy that the officials had that night, thinking that they officiated a good game. Is that standard?
It is. You know what? I don't know of any game, and I'm not speaking for Jim, but I would say I've been in major league dressing rooms and listened to ball umpires and that kind of stuff. And we all have the same pride. It doesn't matter what uniform you're wearing. You're an official. You represent the league. Mm-hmm. You represent your own group of people. And at the end of the day, you want to have the same. I can tell you, I didn't think I was superstitious, but if I had a pregame meal in Philadelphia and went out and had what I thought was a really good hockey game, very content. When I go back to Philadelphia, I'm going back to that same restaurant, having the same pregame meal, but I'm not one of the guys, put my right skate on, my left skate. No, I'm not that superstitious.
Yeah.
We have the same pride that an athlete wearing a hockey or a ball sweater wears. And when we come in after a game, we know when we didn't work well. We know when things just didn't go our way. And there's no high-fiving in those dress rooms. I can guarantee that. But by the same token, when you talk about a team, absolutely. You know what? If you're able to do that in today's day and age of just going in and seeing it, I listened to people in Phoenix the other day tell me horror stories about going to the cars and chasing officials to the cars, and standing up in the glass and yelling at officials. And at the end of it, we're only hurting our own product because at the end, if we run out of an official in any sport, that sport's not going to happen. And I think people have to realize just how much they hurt the sport when they because that official, doesn't matter what age, whatever, has got a pride in doing a good job. And I know of no one that wants to officiate a sport and be bad.
Was there one guy? Go ahead, Jim.
Ryan brings up a tremendous point there, and I'll be serious. I know I usually joke around, but we're in baseball, and Baseball Ontario, we're still losing young officials because the way they're treated by just not the coaches and the players, but by the parents too. Like 10 or 11-year-old umpire will go off the field and these parents, or they're screaming at them during the game. But the thing that's really disconcerting right now is the assaults. Every day we're reading about, whether it's in Canada or the United States, in any sport, officials being assaulted by coaches and by players and by spectators. That's just ridiculous. And I give some of the U.S. states have really upped the criminal offenses for assaults on officials. Before, they used to just kind of, wow, so a referee or a baseball umpire got knocked to the ground after a game or something. Well, big deal. But now they treat it as a crime, and people are going to prison for it. And I just think, and the spectators got to realize too, and the fans have to realize that we don't cheer, despite what they think, we don't cheer for the teams. We couldn't care less who wins a game. Mm-hmm. Like, and I know Brian will vouch for that, but they think we do. They think we do. Like, I know I got my Bruins cap.
That's why
on,
I would laugh.
Yeah. I know, but I don't referee hockey anymore.
No, I know you don't. I know.
Yeah, I know. I still umpire baseball. This will be my sixth. I can't believe it. I've been yelled at by mothers and fathers, well, mothers especially. This will be the 60 years I've been yelled at by mothers.
Wow.
But How are you putting up with it, Jim?
I don't know. I just laugh it off, and sometimes I'm sure Brian maybe once or twice in his career made a remark to a spectator as he was walking up the tunnel at Maple Leaf Gardens, just kind of quietly enough for that spectator to hear it. I've done the same thing too. We're only human. And Brian's got a pretty sharp tongue. I will give him credit for that.
I've heard him. I've played in games with Brian Lewis as the referee.
Yeah.
It's probably news to you. It's not in the NHL, but he has reffed some of my games.
Yeah.
Well, hold it. Now, was that a game you were playing?
You know,
what kind of a goalie was he? What kind of a goalie was he, Brian? Or is he?
Well, I said to the jury a while ago, I said, you know what? Not only did he have problem with the five hole, he had problem with the 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 hole.
I didn't know they had that many holes.
he does.
You can find them.
You know what the good thing is? You know what the best part about it is? I'm playing the best goaltending that I've ever played right now. Like, I'm playing in men's C league, and I'm playing. I don't know. I'm just getting better.
Well, no, that's
half ice. Is it half ice?
No, it's not half ice, and it's with 30-year-olds.
I'll send a scout up tomorrow.
Do that.
Take a look at.
Okay, before we go. Sorry, go ahead, Brian.
One thing that Jim was talking about here.
Yeah.
Each one of us have our own personal pride. I have been involved in either wearing or caring about people wearing a striped shirt for 65 years.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? At the end of the day, to be able to take one of those youngsters that you see someplace, and I think of a kid that was in Victoria, he's working the National League today because you're able to take him and guide him along the way. So it's not only what you can do for yourself, it's what you can do for others. All right. You call it mentoring, you can call it coaching, you can call it whatever you want to. That sometimes offers you personal pride. The only way we're ever going to stop of abusive officials, and I said this to our local referee in chief, if he and I are on the ice and somebody up there is belittling and berating, we have the authority to stop the game and say this game will not be played until that gentleman or lady up there in the red sweater leaves the building so they can understand the magnitude of what's going on. And I've actually been on the ice with kids who have cried because of as a result of their parents yelling down at them for doing something.
No.
That's wrong.
I wish all sports would bring that rule in, especially Baseball Ontario. It's needed. It's needed. Mm-hmm. And the parents need to know that that's going to happen. If they cheer for your kids, cheer your kids on. Yeah. Don't even be yelling at the players on the opposing team. I just don't get it. And no. That's probably what infuriates me more when I'm umpiring a baseball game, hearing parents yelling at the other kids, the kids on the other teams.
Yeah.
Brian, go ahead.
Well, it's the number one challenge, I think. You know, I was going to ask the guys what they thought that was. It's very obvious what it is. It's the number one challenge facing officiating across all sports, and it's got to stop. Clarky, go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. Just, I know we've kept Brian a long time, mostly because Jim's computer wasn't working. But before we let you go, was there one guy, Brian, who chirped at you, who you looked at the schedule and you go, oh, I got to put up with this guy tonight?
Yes.
Can you name him?
No.
Come on. Did he play for Canadian team?
He passed away.
Okay.
And his it's Joe Blow.
Yeah.
And I remember saying to him, do you whine and cry like this to your mother? And then he became a scout that was traveling on behalf of a certain team, and I would run into him in Billings, and it was still the same. I have no problem with an athlete asking a question. It's when you come to me and you're whining. just ask me and I'll give you an honest answer.
Yeah.
Why in this particular, and I'll tell you why you don't answer these questions. If you're at a hockey banquet and somebody said, who's the dumbest player, their dirtiest player, whatever have you, that you had to referee, you don't answer that. Because invariably, somebody in the room puts up their hand and said, Joe Blow's my uncle.
Yeah, I know. Yep. I understand. But I have to ask.
Well, no, but you've asked it every time we've chatted. You got the same response.
Okay, one other question then that you won't answer. Are you ever going to tell us the real story of what happened after the Brett Hull goal?
Sure, I typed it out and sent it to every staff, every employee of the National Hockey League got a copy of what went on and what didn't go on and what we did and why we did it.
Okay.
It's okay. In print.
It was the right call?
It had to be the right call. It happened.
It didn't have to be, because the Stanley Cup, the team was celebrating on the – sorry, I'm not going to get into it. I've already got into it with you.
That was fine. On. We were looking
his
at –
foot was in the crease.
We were – Yes, but it was a rebound off the goalie, and a rebound off the goalpost does not change the possession factor. I'll send you a rule book from 19, whatever year it was.
99. It was
99. I just love having fun. And you know what? The other thing, too, is like you haunt me, right? I'm on Facebook the other day, Adam. This is your cue. And a picture comes up of Yuri Sira. There's the great Leaf goaltender, Yuri Sira. And look who's behind him. Looking, lurking, and seeing the puck. And you can see the puck there, too. You can see the puck. Of course, it's going through Yuri Sirha. He didn't save that one. But there's Brian Lewis, ready, right on the spot, looking right at the – it's perfect, perfect officiating.
So I got that one right.
I think you might have.
Well, that's not bad. It's a good way to end the career. I got one right.
Out of what, 100,000 calls, you got one right? That's awesome.
He was good. And you know what? He's been, we kid a lot. He's been very generous to me. And like when I worked at the Fan, we used to have a charity hockey team and he came on the air a lot. He's the director of officiating for the NHL and he's out there refereeing our games, our charity hockey games. So he's been a good friend for a long time. And I thank him for all the stuff he's done. You've been good.
Well, when I was reporting, if I was at an NHL game and Brian was there supervising, it was fun. It was always fun to run it. Well, that's how I ended up getting this rule book. You had
it. I don't have that. I don't have an autograph.
I know. What? I'm going to, oh, you know what, Clarky, for you, I'll put this on eBay.
Okay. Can you send me one? Can I give you my address, Brian? You can send me one. I might have an old one. I probably do. Oh, you know what? I should have brought that out tonight. I have a rule book from like 1930 something.
Well, look.
From my dad.
The one that Brian's got, hold it up. Look how thin this one is compared to the one that he's got right now.
Yeah. And then you get the case book, the case study book.
It's double.
Right? The case study book's even bigger.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Isn't that the problem, Brian, that they just keep adding rules and rules and rules, and the poor officials are the ones who have to keep enforcing all of this stuff in any sport.
Yeah. Thank God we're not in the NFL.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah. Well, how about Major League Baseball? We had 10 umpires, just packed it in at the end of last season. They just decided they'd had enough. Yeah. Yeah.
Any of the bad ones?
Did Angel Hernandez go? I don't think so.
You know,
he's
what?
One in a million.
Angel is not
Don't start. Let's not get into this. Let's wrap this up right
Angel
now, Ryan. Ryan, get in there.
Angel just does some stuff on the field that gets himself noticed.
Yeah, bad call.
He's not a bad umpire, really. But anyway, that's it.
We'll agree to disagree there, Mr. Boston Bruin. Brian, thank you so much for doing this. Jim, always a pleasure. It's great to have you guys on here to chat with us. Brian, again, like Clarky said, you're very generous to us. You've been generous to him, even though he gets scored on all over the place. I'm sure you saw a lot of goals go by him, but that's why you're a Hall of Famer. Congrats again on getting into the Ontario Sports Hall of Fame. We're really happy for you, my friend. Thank you guys for doing this.
My pleasure. Thanks, guys.
I just want to say, Brian, I still think your hair is way better than Carrie Fraser's hair.
My hair is either gray or missing.
now that's an endorsement. That is an endorsement for the Hall of Famer. We love it. All right. Thanks so much, guys. We'll take a quick break. When we come back, Clarky and I will continue our conversation about refereeing and we'll review the Leafs game the other night. That wasn't very good for Clarky's lads. That's coming up next here on Instigating. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Instigating with Clarkie and Drury. Thanks so much to our great friends, Brian Lewis, longtime NHL referee and director of officiating, and of course, Jim Kressman, longtime baseball umpire and reporter. Back here, myself, Ryan Drury, and Chris Clark. Let's review our Players' Championship pick.
Yes, let's Clarkie, do it.
It went very well for you. You made some great calls. Even the bottom guy, that your dark horse, Wyndham Clark, did very well for you. I had some tough goes.
One guy killed you.
Well, not really though, because I mean, Colin Morikawa, he really fell off after the second day. And I mean, you know, you're looking at your team. You had a really, really good team. I mean, you picked the winner. I mean, is there anybody better than Scottie Scheffler right now?
No.
Like, he is on another level good.
No. And I was kind of worried that, because I picked Pendrith first, I was kind of worried that you were going to pick Scottie, but I had a feeling you were going Morikawa way. So that's why I thought I could get Scottie second. But you know what? Pendrith really got +8 on Sunday. He didn't have a good Sunday, but he was there right after, like, day two. He was right there. But anyway, it was fun to watch. Thigala,
it was a great tournament.
+10.
Yeah, Thigala hurt me.
It would have been better if he missed the cut.
Back.
It would have been better if he missed the cut, because he wouldn't have been +10 if he missed the cut, right?
Yeah.
Spieth had a good Sunday as well. He had a good day.
So. He really did. Yeah, he's starting to turn it around. And I mean, he's starting to drive the ball a little better, which is the biggest thing for Spieth.
Speaking of drive,
we did this last week,
but you just tweaked my interest here again. Because at Larry Hudson's, we have some Sierras 22s on for 1.49% financing. You cannot find that interest rate anywhere. Select number of 22s that we still have in stock. They are going fast. People want to take advantage of this 1.49 finance. So if you want one, come on in. Larry Hudson's, 1000 Wallace Avenue North in Listowel. If you have a sales rep, go talk to them. If you don't, if you're looking for one, you want to talk to me, just ask for Clarkie and I'll help you out. And also, if you're a Costco member, you get another $750 off, because it is truck month at Larry Hudson's. We'll hopefully see you there.
Yeah, absolutely. Clearing the lot. Look at this. Clarkie and our friends at Larry Hudson's doing their best. Yeah, it's truck. Hey, if you're a truck person, you're looking for a new vehicle, go down there and see our friends. Maybe it's Clarkie that ends up.
Trade values are still very high. So if you have
new wheels, trade values very high, obviously on a number of different types of vehicles. So if you're after a truck, there's no better time to get one than truck month. It's a month for trucks. Go get one. With our friends at Larry Hudson's. Hudson's has it. Let's talk a little bit about somebody who didn't have it on Monday night, or a group of people that didn't this week. Boy, your Leafs. They're still playing really well. They were going for 3 in a row here. Really exciting game with Edmonton on Saturday. Boy, they did what Buffalo did to them on Monday. They came back from 3 down. Like
Mr. Fancy Pants. Holy, did he have a game.
I think you got to stop calling him that. He's literally the best player on your team.
Yeah, but he's always going to be Mr. Fancy Pants. But he's fancy. Like, he is. He's a fancy guy.
But it's a good way.
Yeah, sometimes it is. Sometimes it's bad. Sometimes it's bad. Sometimes it's good. He's been really good lately. No question about it. He's on fire.
I'd argue a majority of the time it's really, really good. Yeah, I'm sure you do, because he leads the NHL in takeaways.
Yeah, well, did he... I texted a picture to your boss at the radio station during the game there, who's an Edmonton Oilers fan. And it was a picture of some Apple turnovers, and all said is free turnovers. I texted that to him. He didn't respond.
I'm sure he didn't.
I mean, it was giveaway night. It was turnover night. And at Scotiabank
Arena. Both teams were terrible. Oh, my God.
It was an exciting game. Not one the coaches like, but one the fans like. And you know what? I haven't been to a Leaf game in a long time, Ryan. Like, it's been a long, long time. And I looked, I'm going, you know what? This would be probably a good game to go to. And then the $350 ticket scared me off. I wanted to go, though. It would have been a good one to go to. But I can't spend $350. I can't.
No, I can't.
But if someone wants
to
give me tickets,
that's a topic for another day. Yeah, right. Somebody dig out a ticket for Clarkie here. Come on. I can't do it either. And I'm not even a Leaf fan. I don't know that there will ever be, you're sidetracking me now. I don't know if there will ever be an occasion where I ever grace that building ever again. I can't do it.
You know who's going to be there in August? August 8th. I'm going to be dancing on the ceiling once again.
Yep. Is he coming back again?
Yeah.
Your guy?
Lionel's playing Scotiabank Arena with Earth, Wind,
not
and
Messi.
Fire. No.
Not Messi.
No.
Who can, you know, dance who on the ceiling?
Yeah. Yeah, my daughter Jenna is coming and some friends.
Is it me you're looking for?
Jenna, my daughter is a huge Lionel Richie fan. And
I wonder why that is.
She also made those shirts that you're wearing.
Yes, our instigating
shirts. Instigating
shirts.
If you
want one, let us know.
Shout out,
you know,
to Jenna for Reach making
out
those shirts for us.
So Jenna,
yeah, they're for sale.
Jenna's a beauty.
They are for sale. So if you want one, just let us know.
Yeah.
Who, depending on who we'll you are, out, we'll set the price. That's the way it works.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. If our friend Brian Lewis wants one, free. Right.
But that's funny thing. That's probably the last time no. I went to see another concert, like just in the fall. I forgot. I saw at
Scotiabank?
Scotia. That's the last time I was there. It was, yeah, Michael Bubbles.
Oh, yeah. I totally forgot that you went to see Bubbles.
Yeah. And he put the Leafs jersey on. And
I bet it was unreal.
And all that stuff. It was good. I'm not a huge Michael Bublé fan, but it was okay. It was fine. I'm going to probably enjoy Lionel and Earth, Wind, and Fire a little bit better.
Sure.
Philip Bailey's the lead singer for Earth, Wind, and Fire. He's a good singer. He's really good.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you,
you
for sharing
who
that.
Philip Bailey is? Come on.
No, I know who Earth, Wind, and Fire is, but
okay.
I don't know.
Well, they're opening for Lionel. So,
are they really? Wow, that's a pretty good bill.
It's good. Yeah,
that is what you're looking for. Good
it
for
is
you, man.
Hello, I told you that.
Hello.
Yeah.
No,
where were
good
we
for you, man?
So the Leafs. I want to go to a game.
Yeah, for sure. Well, and the Sabres. Look, the Sabres are just desperate
tickets
to stay in it. Like, well, playoff tickets, you're going to double your price there. So, I mean,
I
we'll see.
Yeah.
Get a start a GoFundMe.
It's tough.
I don't know.
It's tough though. Like the Leafs are like second, like Buffalo was desperate. Buffalo needed the win. And it's
they're
tough.
Coming.
It's
like
tough.
I think next year they them in Ottawa, even Detroit, like the worst of the Atlantic, it like is starting to get, you can see progress. Which overall is exciting. Like you don't want, you know, Arizona's littered all over the place, you know.
If they still had their goalie, what's his name in Boston now? Allmark.
Oh, yeah.
They have Allmark this year. They could be in the playoffs right now. Like if he plays
the way
Boston's a better team, but he's
no, but the way he's playing, like he's stolen some games for Boston. My God, he was really good against Detroit the other day. Jeez. And then, you got Swayman there too. Boston, God almighty, are they ever good? Like,
they're good.
Holy.
We'll see what happens in the playoffs. We'll see what happens.
Absolutely.
How long has it been since the President's Trophy winners won a cup? It's been a long time, I think. 10 years, 12 years, something like that. So would have been
the lockout shortened Blackhawks in 12-13.
Yeah,
they won a silly amount of games. The 48 game season, I think they won like 39 games or something.
We'll have
like
to get Jim back on second round Leafs Boston preview. We'll get
100%. I like the confidence. I like the confidence.
They got to
win. Should be my
God,
they got to. I laid a bet on the Leafs actually with our friends on Cool Bet. I laid a bet on them making the Western Conference final or
the
Eastern Conference final.
By the way.
Yes.
Our buddy Ian Doig back up to his posts on Facebook about the Leafs.
What's he got?
Oh, last night. Once again, last night, he says, I think it's time to cheer for another team. Any suggestions?
No.
And what I said to him was, well, there's three teams better in the 32 team NHL better than the Leafs. So pick one of them. Like, what do you want? You want them to win every single game all the time? Like, look at people who think, oh, the Leafs are never going to beat Tampa the way they're playing. Have you seen how bad Tampa's been for the last 3 weeks? They've been
Coach Coop
awful.
Coop calling
awful
out the Stars. Like, it's not gone well down there.
Like the Leafs have definitely played a
but
lot better.
But you can
than
forgive
them.
The fans down there likely don't care. They're just like,
no,
look
they
at
don't
these guys.
No,
three
sure
cup runs, you know,
yep,
like
yep,
one, two.
Maybe
of
they're
them
saving it up.
What it is. What it is, right? And I can tell you this from experience, you know, as a Caps fan, when your team has not won, every little road bump feels, you know, so much worse. Yeah. Every playoff disappointment, it just hammers. You remember?
I get it. I get
together
it, man. But
I'd come into the office just, I wouldn't speak for a week. It was just gut wrenching. Then they won, right? You know,
I know they
it was
won.
Maybe more like a day. But I wouldn't speak like.
But like I watch a game and they lose and I'm like, dang, they lost, right? I'm like, but I'm like, it's time to choose another team to cheer for. Come on, Ian Doig.
I said stuff like that. I said stuff like that in my younger days, watching the Caps.
Your younger days.
My younger days, man. I'm over.
No, 30. No, I know. Come I'm on, just man. Saying. Yeah. Ian. Yeah.
Gut wrenching, dude. 20.
I get it. 16? I get it. But it's game 65.
He's just frustrated because he's never seen them win.
The team is the fourth best team in the NHL. Like, what do you want? What do you want to live through? The 80s again or the.
What he's getting at is that he. Well, what's the difference? There's still no winning. Well, 80s now, they've not won anything.
It's still more enjoyable for them. They still have to play 82 games during the regular season. I get that.
It's more enjoyable on a daily basis. Yes.
Absolutely, it is.
100%. We're not talking about Ballard here. You know, like we understand that. I can understand the frustration as a fan, and you say things when you're a fan and you care that deeply because you get hurt. You get hurt by people. It's like that girl that you just can't let go of. She keeps breaking your heart, but there's something about her, you know? Maybe that's not a great analogy, but there's just that. You know, we've all been in that relationship where it went maybe a year too long, you know, because you just believed something was there. It's because you're hurt so much, and you say things when you're hurt that you don't mean. Doigie's diehard blue leaf, blue and white, till the day he dies. He's just saying things because he's allowing the little needles to dig that extra inch deeper when things don't go their way, because they hasn't seen any playoff success, let alone a cup, in 20 years, you know, 20 years plus. That's what it is. He's not going anywhere. But, you know, it's a long time. That's a long time. It's weird to think about. There's been like four or five generations of Leaf fans that have literally never seen them even come close. It's bizarre. There's a generation of Leaf fans, Clarky,
just stop.
That have never seen them win a playoff series.
Stop. Okay.
Isn't that incredible?
Stop.
There's like 19, 20 year olds that have literally prime of their life kids in college.
I muted them. I muted you. You got on mute. You got to do it. I muted you.
I muted you. Something else. This is the last ever episode of Instigating. I want to thank all of our sponsors. I'm going to get Brian Lewis to be look official at on this
so
show.
Hard, I'm turning red. That was hilarious. Yeah. I'm muted. That's it. You're done. Adam, producer Adam's probably saying, oh, we lost his mic.
Yeah. Way to go, dude. Really, really, really cool there. Yeah. I do want to say, though, as we end, I want to, you know, go full circle here and come back to talking about the officiating. You know, Jim alluded to it. I like the baseball stuff. I like the pitch clock. I'm a big fan. Yeah. I like it so far.
Yep.
He alluded to like the NFL. The NFL just continues to be that weird monster that is just you can't understand it. They're so big that they can just do anything. And the calls and the rule changes constantly. And now they're gonna make roughing the passer reviewable and all this. It's like, my God, because there were some brutal ones. Like it flag football. You can't hit the quarterback.
I don't know what a catch is anymore. Like, I don't know what a catch is. Because like I don't know what a catch is. And it's like the guy catches it and always got to make contact with the ground with the ball in the hand. And I'm like,
got to make a football move, Clark.
The guy caught the ball. Like, he caught the ball. I don't have to make a football move. He caught the ball. That's what I don't get. Those are the kind of things that drive me crazy. I watch a replay and I go, he caught it. And then they're like, no, he didn't make a football move.
I know.
That's the stupid.
I'm part. Confused because like if I'm. They overcomplicate it. Like if I'm falling backwards and you throw a ball at me and I fall backwards and I catch it with one hand and one foot off the ground and I fall down and the ball never leaves my hand as I hit the ground, what would you say?
Well, it's a catch.
I caught that ball that you threw at me.
Yeah.
But in the NFL, you got to get both feet down. I couldn't do that. I couldn't fall backwards out of bounds, catch the ball with my one foot down,
right,
and fall backwards out of bounds.
You can't get CFL. My second you foot can't down. In the NFL.
Yeah, it's dumb. Yeah, like that should be things. A catch. Part of my body was in bounds.
Yeah.
And I caught the ball. I just like, what's, you know, I don't understand it at all. Speaking of the NFL, some big moves going on. It sounds like it's getting close to Aaron Rodgers going to the Jets. My God, he's Brett Favre. He's Brett Favre 2.0. It's incredible. He sat in the little dark room and he wants to go to New York for some reason, who, to be fair, have a very talented defense, but I don't know who he's going to throw to. And then Jimmy G's off to Vegas. And then they trade Darren Waller. Like, my God, like the NFL silly season starting to pick up.
Vegas had to do something. They have a rabbit fan base down there and they just always seem to suck. So
in Oakland. Yeah.
Absolutely. No, in Vegas.
They have a rabbit fan. No, they don't.
Well, I think.
Go think back and look at the video of any of their home dates. Over half the building is the visiting team. It's not good. It's not good. I'm telling you.
I had a tour of that stadium.
It's not Arizona bad.
Anyway, but yeah, I think they could be like the Golden Knights and really have a lot of their own fans there, but they don't like.
Well, they better start winning. Well,
right. That's what I'm saying. Anyway,
better start winning and they're going to, they're going to latch their hopes to Jimmy G.
I had a tour of it.
Beautiful stadium.
It's unbelievable.
Beautiful stadium.
Yeah.
But the arena in Arizona was nice too. Glendale, I should say.
Hey, quickly. We have only a couple minutes left. NHL expansion is on the docket, apparently. They're talking.
I can't do this with you at this point in an episode.
Atlanta, Kansas City. Any other places where the NHL has failed before that we want to take a team back to?
I heard like Houston again.
Houston's Portland. There, Toronto again.
Imagine Atlanta. For a third time?
Kansas City, the scouts come back too. Yeah,
I know. Yeah, Atlanta for a third time.
I know.
The Atlanta Thrashers.
Can't be true.
Couldn't get Let's fans to come ever.
You know who we should get on next week? Our buddy from The Athletic, Sean Fitzgerald, would be good to talk about this.
Why don't you get him on Let's here, and maybe he'll host the whole show with you like Steve McAllister did with me.
You're on the
I'm
beach.
On vacation.
You're on the beach.
I'm going down to the Dominican Republic. My Very little nice. Brother is getting married. That's he beat me to it. So he cool. beat me to it. My little Where's brother's Kate? Getting married.
What does Kate think about this?
She doesn't care. She's not like that. She's not like, come on, like, you know.
Hurry it up.
Yeah. No, my little brother's getting married.
Yeah, well, you have a good week. Getting hitched. Buddy.
It's going to be unbelievable. Yes, I'll be back in a couple weeks.
Yeah.
And it's going to be really fun. Maybe I'll check in with you. If the internet's good down there, I'll check in with
you.
I'll pop on the show. Give me an update.
Sounds good.
I will, dude. All right, that's it for us here at Instigating. Thanks again to Brian Lewis and our friend Jim Cressman for chatting about officiating across sports. You can watch this show Friday nights at 8, Sunday nights at 9 with our friends on Whiteman TV. That's channel 6 for Whiteman subscribers. We debut on our YouTube channel every Friday night at 9 p.m. Follow us on social media at Instigating Pod and find the podcast version on all of your favorite podcast apps. For our great sponsors, Cool Bet Canada, the Listowel Squash Courts, Larry Hudson's Chevrolet Buick GMC here in beautiful Listowel. I'm Ryan Drury. That's Clarkie. We will be back, or at least Clarkie will, next week with more Instigating.